Okay, so the next speaker is Robert Schlegel, and he's going to give us an international perspective on innovation in catalysis, which is required for net zero.
All right, good morning, everyone. I hope you can hear me.
And yes, we can hear you.
We can also see the screen, hopefully. So thanks for inviting me. I was thrilled by the opening statements, I must say, because I would wish that our government would have heard them. I like this very strong determination and these very clear messages, which is not essentially what we tend to get from our politicians. So congratulations to that. Now I go a little bit deeper into the subject, and what I want to talk about is the essential role of catalysis as a science and as a technology for sustainable energy systems. Unfortunately, I will not despair from showing you a few data, and that is the reason why I have to thank my co-working group. I don't mention all their names, but I'm very grateful to their excellent work, because otherwise I couldn't be here and talk to you. Now, why do we need to hurry up? This is well known by everyone, but I would like to stress this very clearly, that we have to prioritize our resources and also our efforts. We can state that the 2-degree target is reached already now, so we don't have any more time. I will show this in a moment. The global temperature is high enough that we can say also that 1.5-degree target is over. We had yesterday an interesting discussion with Germany, with climate scientists, and they urged me also to make this very clear, that these political statements that we are going to reach the 1.5-degree scenario possibly is not true. We should better think about what do we have to do to mitigate the changes. A few data, this is measurements, not models. This is the mean temperature of Europe, and you see very clearly where the 2-degree line is. And that is the global CO2 concentration in the atmosphere. And I have to say, this is a devastating slide, because whatever has been talked about, when you look at the slope of this curve, you see zero change. The slope is constant. That means whatever we have talked about, it has not reached our problem. And that is the reason why we better now begin really to do something that is serious. So this is what we have to do. Normally to a more broader audience, I wouldn't show this slide, but you are all experts, so we can discuss this very clearly. Future energy systems have two parts. They have power and they have hydrogen plus its derivatives. And they are equal and they are interconnected through grids. And that is something that in the discussion that we hear is sometimes not very well recognized, that you need to be ready with your infrastructure and with all of your grids in order to be able to share the switch between the two types of energy carriers that we have here. We have also, of course, some inputs, and you might be surprised that you find in my input list also natural gas and oil. Because I do think when we talk about the hurry up situation, that we should use whatever we can do in order to start as quickly as possible to reduce our CO2 emissions. And for that, natural gas is certainly for quite some time an option. And oil is certainly not an option for generating energy, but oil is definitely something that we will possibly see for quite some time as raw material in the chemical industries. I will come back to that in more detail when I go through the rest of my presentation. So I do not want to go into all the errors that you can see, but this is indeed a systemic approach, and it was said twice before, and I applaud to this very much. We have to see this in a system, and when we do prioritization of our resources and our efforts, we also should always contemplate that this is a system. So to make an enormous effort in one area has to be really looked at very carefully, because this is an optimization of many parameters, and you all know that this is not an easy task. So priorities towards low carbon systems. It is clear that this is something that also affects society. And we have seen this also in the helicopter introductory talk, that this is clear to us, but this is not our activity today to discuss the societal aspects of this. But what is an issue is the egoisms that we see. We have, at least in Europe, we see this very clearly. We have now a battle for this scarce renewable energy resources that we have. It's not only electrons, it's also hydrogen. There's this green hydrogen story. And it is obvious that in the next 20 years, there will never be enough green hydrogen around to supply everybody, all industries and all users who want to have that. And I think these egoisms and the fighting that comes from this is a very counterproductive thing that we as scientists should beware of. We should not do that. I see two types of priorities. Politics, it is absolutely essential to motivate in society the value of sustainable goods and services and the related price tags. One of the key drivers why things do not move as quickly as they should is because it's obvious that the sustainable system will cost more than it costs now. And this is cost, not price. And the difference of that is, of course, politics. And it is really important not to say we have to abandon certain activities and we have to decline in our societal activities, but we can develop as much as we want, but we have to be able to understand that this might be has a cost and a price target to it. For science, it is important that we really create and deploy these technologies that enable the fastest decline of fossil energy use. That I don't need to introduce anymore. We have heard it also in the two opening statements. Now, when we look how much energy we have available, then we see what our priority is. We have a very large excess of solar electricity on this planet. It is estimated to be about 4,500 terawatt years of electricity per year available, and mankind needs 18 terawatt years per year, so a very small fraction of that. The issue is not that we don't have enough energy, the issue is storage, transport, and distribution is a challenge because the energy is at the wrong place in the wrong time. And so that is what we have to equilibrate. And this is pretty obvious, this cannot be solved without chemistry and catalysis. And that is the fundamental role that catalysis has to play, simply to equilibrate this demand and supply problem with renewable energy on our whole planet. Now, a very short sign of this is given by the German energy system, where you can see in the German electricity part in the green line, how we get renewable energy contributions in our German electricity system, fine, 50% roughly. But the red line says how much CO2 we were saving in this. And you see very clearly that this has not been done in a systemic way because there's no proportionality in that. The simple reason for that, and it's not a simple reason, there are many reasons why this has happened, is there's a lot of regulatory bypasses and there's the issue of volatility that hasn't been taken care of. And so we are wasting a lot of this renewable energy and this is not used really to reduce the CO2 emission. You have a different system in your country and you are lucky that you have a significant contribution from nuclear. And this is one of the reasons why you do not run into this problem as seriously as we do. Now, what is the role of chemical industries in CO2 emission? That again goes on to prioritization. When we look into the EU and the CO2 emission, then I have given you in this box the total CO2 emission that we have. And in color, you see the contribution that comes from cars, from petroleum refining, and from the chemical industry. That first gives you an indication. The red block is one that comes from chemical industry. And in UK, it is a little bit different, but still the red block is pretty small compared to the gray part or compared to the blue part. That means when we talk about prioritization, then we would say the red part is not possibly our highest priority when it comes to CO2 reduction. I give you now the same figures also for the German situation, simply because only in the German situation, they was able to find the energy that is needed in order to avoid all the CO2. And you see on top of it, the CO2 emissions in the same units as for UK and EU. And in the lower plot, you see how much energy, renewable energy, you would need to avoid the CO2 emission from the respective sectors. And then you see very clearly what efficiency and prioritization means. So you would need 700 terawatt hours of green energy in order to reduce the CO2 emission from German chemical industry. That is not very useful if you think that you need 1,000 terawatt hours to reduce the whole heat emission, CO2 emission from heat, and that is about half of the gray line. So when you make the two comparisons, then you see very clearly that priority goes first to create enough renewable energy available to the total system, and then you can do chemistry. So where does our hydrogen come from if we need so much hydrogen? We have multiple sources of them. Sustainable for a longer term is only water splitting. This is the same source where all the the hydrogen in nature comes from. Biomass and sustainable waste of limited volume. There's a lot of research going on biomass. I'm very well aware of that. But you have to see that biomass has many other duties to fulfill on our planet. And we have to be careful to think about what is the real contribution to our energy supply. Fossil methane is not sustainable, but pyrolysis of methane enables further use of this resource. This is a particular issue that also is important for politics, because you know very well that there are certain countries on this planet that are very rich in methane. And these countries will object the transition, the energy transition, at least on a global scale, very significantly if they cannot make use of their methane anymore. And for that reason alone, it is a good idea to think about methane pyrolysis. This is easy on paper, but whoever has dealt with this chemistry knows that the catalytic part of it is quite involved. But what we have really to consider is all non-water sources of hydrogen are okay to support the transition from fossil to green fuels. Even if in the end, as I said, green hydrogen is the only solution, but this is in the end. And the infrastructure that we need to generate the amount of green hydrogen that we will need in the future will definitely need decades to be built. And so we have to look for all possible sources in the transition period. Again, I indicate this here. You are probably very well aware of that. The only message that I want to send to you is, unfortunately, Mother Nature has organized it in such a way that water splitting is the most energy intensive process that we have. These little numbers that I give you are the thermodynamic minimum energies that you need to use for that. And you see also why it is so attractive to do methane splitting, because it's in energy much more. You get much more hydrogen for your amount of energy that you put in there. But as I said, this is not forever. So local hydrogen, that is a debate that also is very vivid in your country as it is in our country. And that one has to see, of course, this is something for life cycle analysis. What I give on the y-axis, you know this very well, is the carbon footprint for 1 ton of hydrogen, whereas on the x-axis is the carbon footprint for the electricity that you have. And of course, if you want to do something useful, then you have to be below the red line, because the red line is the amount of CO2 that you generate when you do this from methane steam reforming. Now, the German electricity footprint is at the blue line, and you see very clearly when you do electrolysis from the German grid, you better don't do this, you double the CO2 emission. Even at the most positive way of the German system in 2030, we will not be there to do anything useful, because possibly we get the break even. Possibly, because this is the most optimistic assumption about the CO2 footprint in our country. France is way better off, as you can see. You see the effect of nuclear energy, and of course you see it also in the UK. So in the UK, you're already halfway there, or almost there, to do that, but still you would generate, if you make hydrogen from grid electricity, you make more CO2 than if you don't do that. And of course, the thing gets a little bit harder if you don't use hydrogen, but you want to make a fuel out of it. For example, I have now indicated with this yellow line methanol. And then you see, even in your country, it would not be good to make green methanol out of grid electricity, because that is at the moment not possible. The message that I would deduce from that is it is absolutely priority first to get this grid electricity properly done. You do this possibly off-grid in hydrogen with your nice windmills that you have. That's fine, but then you have still a volatility problem. But if you want to connect it on-grid, then you have to be careful that you really looked at the priorities first. It doesn't make sense to do all the chemistry with so-called green electricity if the electricity isn't green. So where from will we get sufficient hydrogen then if local is a problem? And this, of course, depends on the cost factor. The cost of hydrogen critically depends upon the price of electricity. And I have put in bracket, it's in most cases a political price. But what's not political is the annual availability. So the 6,000 hours, runtime hours per year, are a problem also in your country. Even you have your beautiful offshore wind, but also you will not get 6,000 hours directly from offshore wind. And what we also have as a problem that has a priority research agenda is electrolysis is still way too expensive. So electrolyzers need to become much cheaper and not necessarily more effective. So the efficiency argument that we read in research, where it deals about what is the overpotential that we have on a certain electrode, that's one issue, but it's not the most important one. Price is way more important, and not so much research is done about lowering the price of electrolysis. That's a nice global card where you see where are the good areas where hydrogen can be produced at cheap prices. And you see there are two bands on this planet, and it is obvious that most of the areas where you see the red color is in places where people do not want to live, because high intensity of solar energy means it's deserts and storms, and these are not the areas where you tend to like to live. So as I say, there is this transport issue. These areas are blanked out because the cost of transport becomes then prohibitive. At these levels of prices, if you add the transport cost, which we estimate about 30% of the value of hydrogen, make it in such a way that this hydrogen is prohibitively expensive. So we see very clearly where these areas are. So the systematics. So how do we want to use hydrogen? So we need to import this. And I said about a third of the hydrogen cost will be transportation, and transportation is not the logistics, but to make the hydrogen, bring it in a form that is transportable, because we all know gaseous hydrogen is likely not the form where bulk amounts of hydrogen will be sent around the world. We need circular economies, otherwise we will not meet our sustainability targets. And we have a problem in many political areas at the moment, because people tend to think that we should do this in little tranches. So we have in Germany the saying that hydrogen is the champagne of the energy transition. No, I disagree. Hydrogen is the mineral water of the energy transition. It has to come in large amounts and as quickly as possible. When we do this practically, then we see the flow of arguments. We use green electricity, then we convert it to hydrogen. And then we have to have these transport forms. This is either liquid hydrogen, this is LOHC, you know, well, it's ammonia, it's methane, it's methanol. These are essentially the technology options that we have. With all of these, we can do transport and storage. And when we use this kind of hydrogen sources, then we have to do the circular economy. That means you see these feedback errors. And these feedback errors, they decide essentially what kind of technology you would want to use for which kind of application. And I'm a very clear supporter of the idea that we should look in all of these options, because I'm sure that all of these options have a role to play in an energy system. And it is not on science to decide which is the option to follow, because that will be essentially done by market applications. So there's a strong argument against these derivatives of hydrogen, and this is called the thermodynamic crime. I would say the thermodynamic crime is first committed by nature, because it's clear that when you want to synthesize storage molecules out of CO2, you have a price to pay a price for that. That's fine. But as long as you have enough energy, we can certainly afford to pay this price. There's a fraction of this energy stored in the molecule that can then later be released for its use. But of course, the reaction enthalpy to make the molecule can also be used if you have a clever chemical engineering / catalysis technology for that. Nevertheless, we always will lose something, because when we use CO2 as a source of carbon, then we have this water formation and we cannot get out of that. Just for your consumption, I give you a few numbers that you understand how big this thermodynamic crime is. It's about a factor of 2, more or less, that we lose. What is more interesting for the chemists here is, if you make the molecule a bit larger, then of course the storage factor gets larger with respect to CH2 unit that you have in this. And also Mother Nature knows this, and that is the reason why the storage molecule of Mother Nature is fat, which you know very well what that is. And this is of course an efficient way, but unfortunately our technologies are not well suited to work on fat. So energy catalysis, this is the key issue. And this is, I think, quite important to discuss this a little bit, because the objective of catalysis in normal industrial catalysis is different than from energy catalysis, because in industry you want to make products. This is your most important thing, and selectivity and ease of use is very critical. Energy aspects are, of course, important, but they are secondary. If you have choices to do in your catalysis development, you look certainly for the product productivity of the system. for energy transformations, this needs to be reverted because their catalysis is about minimizing energy losses and maximizing energy storage in small molecules. You are usually not interested in the molecule, you are interested in the energy storage aspect. What one also needs to think about is the dimension of what we are talking about. So we're talking about hundreds of millions of tons per year, or even larger when you think about we have 68,000 power stations of more than 1,000 megawatt per year on this planet. This is much, much larger than the dimensions that we talk in chemical industry usually. And that means when we go now down to the scientific part of it, the transport phenomena get very critical. And that is one thing that I want to send out here is that the interaction between chemical engineering and physical chemistry, that is the basis of the whole thing, needs to become way more intense than it is now. Because this derivation that there is a group that deals with active sites and electronic structure, and there's another group that deals with reactor engineering, and they talk sometimes to each other, but of course not regularly. This is a major stumbling block in the evolution of new catalysis science that I think is at least my observation. I show you here now a first scientific example of this. This is partial oxidation of methane. This is a very demanding reaction, as you all know. And what we have done here is we have measured a profile of the gas composition throughout the reactor. And we have done this in micrometer resolution. And then you see that the reaction is completely different inside the reactor as you would think, because normally you would think that hydrogen and methane react to CO and water. And what you see, this is not the case, but you get first complete oxidation and then you get reforming. And this was a debate, it was a mechanistic debate for several decades. And by doing such kind of measurements, you can simply resolve it. This is clear that this is complete oxidation followed by reforming reaction. And what is also interesting is that you can see how sharp these zones are in a reactor. So these are a few micrometers where all the reaction happens. And that is something that we usually do not control when we talk about filling catalysts in a reactor and talking about it. Now, this is an extreme example, of course, because it's so exothermic. I'm very well aware of that. But I think you understand what the message here is. So catalysis is really intricate. We understand this since a very long time because with a non-equilibrium phenomenon, and I don't know need to go to much detail about this. But what I think I want to stress here again is that catalysis is a phenomenon on multiple scales of space and time. And I'm not sure that this is always considered when I read the publications that we all write and how we do our research. And I want again to stress transport of molecules or energy are very critical in particular when you want to store energy in it. And then we have to think about what did we learn about active sites? This is a problem that I want to allude to a little bit more in the next couple of slides. And what I think is what is very important is that we have now understood that there is a feedback loop in these catalyst systems. So performance and active sites influence each other because the local chemical potential is actually what controls active sites. The consequence of it is this fancy diagram. You see here 17 different elementary processes that work on different scales and time. And only the two yellow ones, number 12 and 13, are the evolution of the active sites. All the others have to do with other effects. And that means, and this is the really take-home message from this presentation, is that we really need to consider all of these phenomena in the same depth of information and research as we do this with our physical chemistry. So understanding of catalysis cannot be confined to the molecular level alone. The larger dimensions are also critical. And I think in particular in the middle, so there where chemical engineering stops to be responsible and where active sites are of course too small, there's this mesoscopic dimension. And I think there many things happen that we do not understand very well at the moment. So when we talk about active sites, then we know from model studies that active sites are static in structure. They exist and they are being made when you make the catalyst. And they are high energy sites. And then you begin to worry, why are high energy sites persistent and they can live for years, like ammonia synthesis, they live for 10 years. The answer to that is that this picture is a little bit simplistic. This is incorrect. Active sites are dynamically being formed and they require chemical dynamics of the catalyst. And what does this mean? If you don't do this, then these active sites undergo a phase transition and they deactivate. And the question is, what we have to do when we name our scientific challenges, we have to avoid this phase transition. And of course, if we want to know about phase transitions, then we have to see them. And that is the reason why without operando analysis, we will not be able to do this, because in many cases, we cannot see this phase transition, because if we change the chemical potential by switching off the reaction, then usually many of these reactions are simply being reverted. Now, a classic example for that is the study of Gerhard Ertl, where you see a monoatomic step, NO dissociation, you see the oxygen atoms and everything is fine. And this was a very well received science paper where one can see the active sites. But one also sees that this is not really catalysis, but this is a stoichiometric reaction, because one sees at the on your side, left-hand corner, sees these crystals being formed. These crystals are ruthenium oxide. And as there is no reducing agent there, the ruthenium catalyst is being converted into ruthenium oxide from the oxygen atoms. And in very short time, this ruthenium oxide grows to the step and then the reaction is gone. That is the reason why the step is important, and it does an elementary step that is absolutely critical, but the catalytic cycle is not indicated when you do this. The innovation that we had in the last two decades is that we really understand now that this is dynamics. And this simply comes from the fact that active sites in any material are undergoing this phase transition triggered by the local chemical potential. You can think about corrosion, you can think about cement hardening, if you look in large scale processes. That is not something that is confined to catalysis. Catalysis is a particular area where this phase transition is kinetically hindered. So you want to have what physicists might call a frustrated phase transition. And the dynamical attempt in order to do the phase transition generates the high energy state. So the functional catalyst structure exists only under reaction conditions with the real material. And that is again the reason, and I have to preach this as much as I can, without operando analysis, you wouldn't even know that this exists. A graphical example to that in an energy time diagram would look like this. The bulk phase of the catalyst gives you the reference value. The surface, of course, is higher in energy. If you do nanochemistry, then you still get a little bit of more higher in energy, but this is time invariant, and that is not enough to do catalysis. Only if the reactants come to the system, then you get the interaction. You go high in potential energy, you change your high energy, you get your high energy sites. And the non-successful catalyst is the one where it deactivates according to the dashed line rather quickly. And the successful catalyst is one where the phase transition is hindered and you have this oscillatory situation between two energy maxima, and that is the successful working catalyst. That is what we need and that is what we want. And again, it's understandable if you only work on the static system, you will possibly not know and you will not design the system that we need. I have enough time. I give you quickly, this is now 2 minutes of your kind attention to the one example where I want to show you how this dynamics looks like. This is nickel. And this nickel is now in hydrogen plus oxygen, the most simple reaction that I can do, but this is important for fuel cells. And what we do now, we observe with a microscope what happens to this polycrystalline nickel if I change the ratio between hydrogen and oxygen by changing the flow rate of oxygen into the system at constant temperature. And now you just please sit back and observe for exactly 1 minute what happens to this catalyst. And then maybe you understand what dynamics means. All this is real time, or it's almost real time. No, it's not real time, it's a little bit faster. You see the time stamp is on the top left of the picture. And you see this macroscopic motion. This macroscopic motion is the strain of the catalytic material. That is the reason why one has this problem of sintering and deactivation on a mechanical macroscopic scale. So it's almost done, and you will see how that stops. When you have too much oxygen, then you convert nickel from nickel hydride into nickel oxide. That is the reaction that happens here. And that changes, of course, the system completely. And if you do this dynamically, reversibly, then you also understand quite quickly what kind of challenges we have when we design a catalyst under static conditions and ignore the effect that happens that comes from the reactants. I'm almost done. One point that has not been maybe brought to the general attention of this discussion so much is digital catalysis. So catalysis 4.0, where we understand we do now everything on computer. has started this paradigm of artificial intelligence and machine learning, and that is, of course, now a big hype, as we all know. The attempts that we see in the literature are designed in such a way that we generate large data sets, or we take the existing literature and then we try to find by one way or another descriptors that allow us to predict novel materials. This is the standard paradigm. I argue a little bit against this because for the following three reasons. I think the literature data are not suitable for that because they're all biased, because we publish only successful catalysts and not non-successful catalysts, but in order to find the real correlation, you need also, of course, all of the attempts. Then in many cases, we find in the literature that our data are unfortunately not enough validated against systematic and statistical errors. But when we look at these machine learning strategies, then we find that the outliers contain a very important part of the information that comes out of this. And if you don't know whether the outlier has a physical reason or is a bad measurement, then of course that's not a good thing. And then what we also learn is the data sets in the literature are usually incomplete and fragmented in metadata coverage. That means we do not know exactly, can we compare different reports on the same catalytic system? I'll show you an example of how dangerous that is in a moment. We try to suggest a better approach, and we think we should do systematic catalysis experimentation and specify how we have done this. And this is what we call a so-called handbook approach, that we are sure that we understand that we have all data together. And then we use theoretical methods that identify multidimensional descriptors in order to give the structure function correlations. That these descriptors have to be multidimensional is a sheer consequence of the complicated graph that I showed you, where I mentioned that the catalysis is a multiscale phenomenon. If the phenomenon is multiscale in time and space, then it is very unlikely that a simple descriptor gives you the relation between structure and function. It has to be complicated. It has to have these different dimensions in. And then you can use the actuators that are in this descriptor and find out what are the physical origins of this correlation. And I think this is a more valid approach than just to say, we take now artificial intelligence and let us predict what is the best possible composition of a catalyst in a given reaction. This is maybe asking too much from this technology. So a handbook, I give you only an example. This is a description of how you have to do analysis if you want to do catalysis science. And you see there are many techniques and technologies that are needed in order to do so. And that is something why I presented here, because your catalysis hub is a perfect setting in order to do that. Not any single group that is working on catalysis would be able to follow such a handbook. But if you do this in an integrated fashion in collaboration, then it is well doable that you come to this kind of insight. Now, high level methodology is not just fancy, it is absolutely essential. I show you here an example of some catalyst. This is not important. And you analyze it with two methods, simply for the chemical composition of the cations, this molybdenum and vanadium. And you have an XRF bulk analysis and you have an XPS standard analysis, and you see they more or less agree. But if you put it into operation conditions and then you probe by synchrotron photo emission the real top surface of the catalyst, then you see there's an enormous difference. And of course, if you don't know that the surface is so different from the rest of this bulk, then of course it is clear that your digital catalysis is bound to fail. And the lower plot shows you the question of what is activity. Any of the data points in this slide is a valid definition of activity because it's a steady state measurement. What does this catalyst do under certain performance conditions that are given here? But when you look now into the parameter space that you use in order to measure catalytic activity, then you find it has many steady state situations. And this multiple steady state information is in most cases of catalysis testing missing, because you only get one number and say the catalytic activity of this is that. And you can very clearly see this is not a good idea. This high dimensional situation that you find here is a simple consequence of this dynamical structure of the catalyst, because under different chemical potentials that you put here, you have different catalyst structures. I'm coming to the end. What are the topics in the future for catalysis science in energy? I think most critical is the transport and the chemical storage of hydrogen. This is the challenge for catalysis. There's dehydrogenation of storage molecules and of substrates. This is interesting, because if you have a transport derivative like ammonia or methanol or methane, then of course you want to recover the hydrogen. Recovering hydrogen from transport molecules is a problem. When you look into your handbook of industrial chemistry, you find these kind of dehydrogenations are not very well researched. I advertise to you methane pyrolysis. You would say, oh, Schlügel, why are you saying this? This is not green. It's very important that we do a little bit on this. Then, of course, come synthetic fuels from hydrogen and CO2. That is a no-brainer, and it has been said in all of the strategies, so it is important. But I would like to mention here the point that the petroleum-based industry is not going to disappear. There is lots of debates that the petroleum industry in 20, 30 years is no longer needed. I would slightly disagree to that, because we will always need liquid fuels for that. And so the upstream part of the petroleum industry might go into change in the future, but the downstream part definitely not. So we will still need these kind of chemistries, and we should try to look how this chemistry can change. If we, for example, think about Fischer-Tropsch reaction, this is something which is a very old technology that is very petrochemical, but the understanding and the control of Fischer-Tropsch processes is by no means in a situation which we would like to see here. Then come hydrogen saving new processes, of course, transfer hydrogenation. You can ask the question, why do I want to convert ammonia into hydrogen in chemical industry if I can do a hydrogenation with ammonia? This is something that is not very well researched, I would say, certainly not in large scales. Then, of course, also bio-based processes are important, and bio-based processes to me have this potential to save a lot of many step synthesis that are extremely energy wasteful. So effective synthesis of complex molecules can certainly be done way better in many cases by biological approaches than by the hardcore chemical approaches. But also that is a no-brainer. You have said this many times and I can only support this. What is important to notice is that all of these points have been said many times, so they're long-standing challenges. But they are not sufficiently solved by problem-oriented work. And I think this simply comes from insufficient continuity in efforts and also in funding support. Of course, Fischer-Tropsch is around since 60, 70 years, and there are thousands of papers on this. And still we haven't solved the problem. We have created a huge space of concepts, of ideas and hypotheses, but we have not been able really to profit from that. And this is why I put this in brackets. We should also think about whether our academic reward system is okay, because we are not rewarded from solving a problem. We are rewarded for getting a nice publication out. And whether this solves a problem is something that one can discuss. Last slide. Hydrogen is the critical enabler for energy transitions and net zero, making energy transitions feasible, as I say, and this is the most important single step in the transformation. This requires the transport of hydrogen with molecules like gas and oil today. So this is why I say green gas and green oil is hydrogen. That is absolutely impossible without catalysis. So catalysis is the strategic science and technology here. And what we have to do is we have to generate cyclic economies of energy carriers. That means we have to think about all steps of such a process, and they're all catalytic. Technology families require electrocatalysis, and not only electro, this is why it's in bracket. Here again, please think big. This is not sufficient to study with a couple of postdocs and PhD students such problems. This is not going to lead us to anywhere. This has to be really big efforts, and that is the reason why one has to do prioritization, and one has really to think, where do I put my resources to? Large volumes and rapid temporal evolution of market penetration of these hydrogen carriers is necessary within the coming decade. This is your aspiration. You do this in 2035. This is fine. I'm sure the globe will not be able to do it by year 2035. And the globe is essentially the playground on which we have to execute this catalysis. The defossilization of chemical industry should first occur by changing its energy base, its energy consumption and its energy generation by using hydrogen and renewable electricity. Replacing the fossil feedstock, so the carbon atoms that they convert is something for later times, because when you do this from CO2, it is enormously energy intensive. And there are other areas in the energy system where one can use this renewable energy as long as it is scarce for a better way in order to reduce CO2. And the last point, again, I'm sorry, after Brexit, the hydrogen economy is an European issue and it has global implications. We should think about how useful national solutions are. And as scientists, of course, we are working anyway internationally. That's the reason why you invite a German guy to give you this statement. That is perfectly normal, and we should hopefully keep it like that. Now brings me to the end. I have two quotes from Albert Einstein. There's no fundamental law requiring simplicity in this process. You have seen my second slide. And you say, this complicated Schlügel, why does it make it so complicated? It's not complicated. It's the minimum essential that we need. And this is maybe more complicated than we would like to have it. And the Red's quote is even better. We cannot solve our problems with the same thinking that we had when we created them. So that's also, there's a big wisdom between that. So we have to think about new ways how to approach this. Thanks so much for your time, and I hope I could enlighten a little bit the discussion.
Robert, thank you very much indeed. That was very, very informative, and we'll definitely inform the breakout sessions for later. I think we need to carry on, and I'd ask EPSRC to provide some perspectives and priorities.